Hello, I'm Carly McAvoy, and today we're talking about the coordinate system intercepts when you're in slope-intercept form. Slope-intercept form is when you have y by itself like this. And so we're going to find the x and y-intercepts similar to what we just did, but these look a little different and the math feels different when you're doing it. But the idea is the same. That is, you want to find your x-intercept, and that's when y is 0. And your y-intercept when x is 0. So we're doing the same thing, but our equations look a little different. This is the kind of equation that we love because we can actually put some meaning to this. What's this meaning, a scenario we could put to this? We're saying, well, this is our starting point. So we could say something like, the school had one culinary arts instructor, but then began to hire two every quarter. So they have a starting point and then they go up. I mean, that's just random. I could say the person had 1 acre but then bought 2 acres every summer or something like that. It doesn't have to be anything in particular, but that's a meaning. That's a starting point, and this is the change that's happening over time. Over here, we have a different thing happening because they have something and they're losing. Let's say you have a $50 gift card, but they take away $3 every month for inactive use or something like that, whatever they call it. They take $3 away every month that you don't use it. That's a big rip, right? But anyways, that could be it. We're starting with $50, but we're losing $3 per month. That's what these equations could mean. You could put a totally different meaning to that, but we know what our starting point was and what the change is. Maybe you have 50 cows. But then you sell 3 every year. I mean, something like that where you have a starting point and then you can see, yes, and I'm losing or I'm gaining something month by month or year by year or summer by summer, whatever, quarter by quarter. Okay, that's just an aside looking at these are not just abstract things that would have no relevance in life. They do have relevance and we're showing you how to work with them in an abstract way. Okay. So if you want to find the x-intercept, you have to make y 0. And so that makes these a little bit harder than the other ones because you have to bring things across the equation. You weren't having to do that so much. Well, you kind of were. But anyway, subtract 1. It's harder for students. That's all I can tell you is that it's definitely harder for students. So if x is 0, I mean if y is 0, x is negative 1/2. Okay, and if y is 0, I mean, if x is 0, good grief, I don't know what I've been saying. If x is 0, then we go back and we say, well, 2 times 0 plus 1, 2 times 0 is 0 plus 1, and y is 1. So if y is 0, x is negative 1/2, and if x is 0, y is 1. Those are our two intercepts, and I've labeled them as A and B. But I could also label them as x-intercept and y-intercept. The acceptable abbreviation A and B saves us some time. And I don't even really have to write as an ordered pair unless I'm requested to do that. I could actually say the x-intercept is negative 1/2 and the y-intercept is 1. And what does that mean? It means my graph crosses the x-axis at negative 1 and the y-axis at positive 1, negative 1/2 and positive 1. Okay, what about the x and y-intercepts for this one? I'm just going to say A equals, and I'm just going to give a number here. But I know that the x-intercept is when y is 0. So I would have negative 3x plus 50. I would subtract 50. And then divide by negative 3. Negative 50 divided by negative 3. Well, two negatives make a positive. And I'm just going to leave it as 50 over 3. And for the second one, I'm saying the y-intercept, what if x is 0? So I say negative 3 times 0 plus 50. And that's easier because that just becomes 0 and I get y equals 50. That y-intercept is so important, and in reality, and we're looking at scenarios that make sense, That's our starting point. So B is where we started. We started with 50 of something and then started losing 3 periodically. Okay, so in the next two, I have fractions in there, which make them a little more challenging for students. And I also left some room, so if we wanted to, we could graph using those 2 points if we wanted to see what that looks like. Okay, so for the first one, A, I'm writing these different ways because I want you to see there are different ways to say this, right? You choose the way you like, but on the computer, if you're using Math Excel, or My Math Lab or any of the Pearson products, they usually have you give them in ordered pair form. So if I want to find the x-intercept, I make y0, and the y-intercept, I make x0. And now, what if y is 0? I'm going to add 2 to both sides, and then I'm going to multiply both sides by 1/2 because I want to get rid of the I'm going to multiply both sides by 2 over 1 because that wouldn't get rid of anything. Multiplying by 2 over 1, I get the 2's to cancel, and I just get x. And over here, 2 times 2 is 4. Hopefully, you caught my mistake when I said multiply by 1/2 before I even did it. The easier one is always the y-intercept. Here, I'm saying that x is 0. And if x is 0, that just cancels out, and we get y equals negative 2. That's always going to be our y-intercept, that number at the end. And this is a scenario where somebody starts off in the hole, or something's in the hole, and then they start gaining 1/2 per whatever, hour, month, whatever. Okay. It's got to be something that can be negative, like you owe money or something. Okay, what if I wanted to draw those two points to show my equation based on those two intercepts. Well, what that looks like is my a-intercept, my x-intercept, which is a, sorry, is 4. My y-intercept, which is b, is negative 2. So given those 2 points, I could show you what my equation looked like. So the process for standard form and slope-intercept form is the same, and you find your A and your B, and then you could plot them to graph. But it's a little different plugging in. It looks a little different with this format. All right, what about A and B here? Well, if I want to find the x-intercept, I need 0, and the y-intercept, I need 0. So what if y was 0? Then I would subtract 3 from both sides. And then I would multiply by the reciprocal, which is 3/2. And what that does over here is it makes the 2's cancel and the 3's cancel, and we get x. And over here I have 3 times negative 3, which is negative 9/2. So I have negative 9/2 as my x-intercept. We cannot abbreviate x and y intercept with x and y. We have to use a and b. That's an important point. Okay, now what about if x was 0? Well, we keep doing that. We keep seeing when x is 0, we got this number at the end. When x was 0, we got this number at the end. When x was 0, we got this number at the end. We can start to see that that always happens. If x is 0, 2/3 times 0 is going to be 0. So we're just going to get y equals 3. So we don't need to do any work to find the y-intercept. When it's in slope-intercept form, it's just this number at the end, and it includes the sign in front of it. So there's my 2 points, and I could graph those if I would like. See, it does not take very long to make a graph with a ruler and just be a little precise about things. And these you can buy at the dollar store for a dollar, these little rulers, so it's not a big expense. All right, so now we're going to go negative 9/2, which is negative 4.5, which makes it easier for me. 1, 2, 3, 4.5, to think about it as a mixed number. And then the y-intercept, which is where it crosses the y-axis, is 3. 1, 2, 3. And so we can connect those to make a point. In this scenario, somebody started with 3 and they're going up 2/3 every time. Okay. All right. Have a fantastic day. We'll see you.